wish death upon me. Calling my eyeball a PNG. Hating my videos on PSP. Y'all still watching me anyway. Many men, many, 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 many men wish death upon me. Folks, today marks a very special day, as it is the birthday of my good friend Curtis 50 Cent Jackson. I'm sure by now you've heard of him, whether it be for his massively popular albums, his acting roles, or his business ventures. 50 and I go way back, and we've always had a lot in common. What with him being shot 9 times and me getting a hyperscan for Christmas, we've both had our fair share of hardships. So, we're gonna party like it's his birthday because it is. After patiently waiting, he has finally granted me his blessing to talk about one of his boldest ventures, his video game titles. He also said I get one free vitamin water joke. Any more than that and he'll kill me.
Bitch! It's over for you!
My life's on the line. So, before I self-destruct, let's dive in. G-U-N! I myself always knew 50 Cent would be perfect for a video game, ever since I saw the music video for Heat way back, and lo and behold, we got a few. These two games have always kind of been stuck in the realm of I can't believe this even exists, but I think what these games meant for hip-hop as a whole has largely gone kind of overlooked. And it's really hard to convey just how huge of a phenomenon 50 Cent was with his debut. Immediately, he was like everywhere, and I don't think what he accomplished in the early to mid-2000s will ever be replicated in quite the same way. Not only were the songs instant classics, not only did he quickly blow up as a rapper, but he quickly flooded every facet of entertainment where eventually his persona itself became larger than his own music. You gotta think, the bling era was still in full effect, and 50 managed to make selling out cool, because he was still true to his brand, and he was seemingly everywhere. Look at this, in 2005 alone, he released his second album, a movie titled after his first album, a soundtrack to that movie, a video game, and a mixtape for that game all in 1 year. That is unheard of. If Eminem didn't reject my idea for 8 Mile and Game Boy Advance in 02, he could have been able to say the same thing. You fucked up, Marshall. So for 50 Cent to come out with a video game, which had his entire face encompassing the cover, it was a massive flex. Around this time in the early 2000s, there was a nice spur of hip-hop-centric games coming out, and a lot of them dealing with gangster life or city crime, and while there were a lot of titles that prominently featured hip-hop soundtracks and a hip-hop flair, or had rappers lending their voices to characters or playing exaggerated versions of themselves, this was the first time one rapper got his own big action game, 50 Cent Bulletproof.
Dump it, the drama really means nothing to me. I ride lines, blow your brains out. It's no time to cock it. No way you can stop it when niggas run up on you with them things out. I do what I gotta do. I don't care if I get caught. The DA can play this motherfucking tape in court. I keep on.
Here you play as my man Fitty rolling through the streets of New York in a somewhat over-the-shoulder third-person shooter with your posse of gangsters. A G-Unit, if you will. As you try to get to the bottom of who shot 50.
Aw, he's sleeping.
Right off the bat, there's a whole lot this game does combat-wise that is very impressive for a pre-Gears of War third-person shooter. You can hold up enemies hostage and use them as a meat shield years before Gears of War 2 did it, and you can even interrogate them for info, only furthering my theory that this game somehow is a spin-off to Metal Gear Solid 3.
Talk, punk bitch!
Ow! I don't know nothing!
You going down, son! 50 Cent, bitch!
50 also has a stamina bar, which he can use to pull off these close-up, extremely gory execution kills. Each level here is typically pretty linear, and you'll be shooting through waves of enemies with pistols, revolvers, and guns the size of Little Bow Wow. And of course, a big part of the hustler lifestyle is money, as you can turn enemies into Swiss cheese and pick their pockets for jewels, cash, anything you could find. Aw, shit, is that a Power Player Super Joy 3? In true gangster fashion in this game, you can grab a dude, blow his brains out, and steal his credit card information. And as for the rest of G-Unit, their AI is actually pretty smart here. They'll actually effectively take down enemies. Sometimes they'll stroll around aimlessly, but for the most part, they work well, and Tony Yayo actually ended up saving my ass a few times. Lloyd Banks is your glorified R2-D2, which is not a sentence I thought I'd ever say, as he'll help you and your crew unlock and knock down doors.
Lloyd Banks acknowledged!
Successfully aiming precisely at an enemy's head for a few seconds before firing will net you these extreme melon bursting headshots too hot for MTV. If you pull this off, picking their pockets will usually net you 50, times the amount of money. But since this is New York, bodies disappearing are nothing unusual. Even if you get a bunch of these precision headshots in a row, you have to work fast because you have about 10 seconds before they'll disappear.
All right. We're back to sleep. Just close your eyes. And think of pussy.
Between each level, you get this little hub world of 50s neighborhood. This is where you'll be flaunting all the cash you collected. Really, it's a miracle 50 Cent was ever able to escape these harsh streets on account of all these invisible walls in the way. It's like a metaphor or some shit. First, you got 50's apartment, where you can watch 50 Cent music videos, and you got a great stack of albums to listen to, like, Get Rich or Die Trying.
Or, you know, maybe Get Rich or Die Trying.
What a great place to unwind and wash all this blood off with some nice, refreshing water. But not as refreshing as brand new Formula 50 vitamin water, which you can buy in this game for thousands of dollars to permanently upgrade your health. The most important item in the game is vitamin water. That's wonderful. Oh, true to real life, 50 Cent can also buy bootlegs of his own music on the streets, also costing you thousands of dollars per song.
That cool, man. Maybe he won't notice.
Wait a minute, this one's not even out yet. And hey, how'd you get that one?
Oh shit, is that a ghost?
Also appearing here are Dr. Dre and Eminem, but instead of playing themselves, they play as these completely different characters, with Dre being your trusty arms dealer and M playing a crooked cop. But wait, they were like a huge part of 50 Cent's career. When this game is supposed to take place is kind of unclear. It's implied 50's already a famous rapper, but he's still operating as this weapon expert force of nature street level gangster. But it's like, do Dre and Eminem exist in this world? Will the real PS2 Slim Shady please stand up? Obviously, with a game like this, it's just a very exaggerated, hyper-violent, guns-blazing story based on 50 Cent, bringing a whole new meaning to the word semi-autobiography. In the back of Dr. Dre's van, you can buy different weapons and a copy of Detox if you 100% the game, that's real. It's a decent selection here. You got your AKs, AYAWs, AYAW. Ducking behind cover also comes into play during shootouts, and it's a mixed bag. For a 2005 third-person shooter, it works okay. Sometimes the controls can be kind of finicky and really screw you over when you're glued to cover and can't get out in time. Oh yeah, you'll be dying a lot. Over and over and over and over again. Get ready. Because by the end of Bulletproof, this Ed Hardy t-shirt looking ass artwork will be burned into your retinas. It's difficult to tell how much of this game is actually challenging by design and how much of it's just broken because of how poorly thought out some of these controls and mechanics are. The checkpoint system here is sort of based on each new location within a level, so that means if you die, which you will, that can cost you sometimes as up to almost 15 minutes of progress. But that's not even the frustrating part. I mean, it is, but what's truly frustrating is that this game was so close to being something really special, and I mean it. A few tweaks and reworks in these very specific areas, and I really think this game really would have gone down to be something very special. The most damning issue is the aiming. It's just atrocious here. Unless an enemy is stationary, it's almost impossible to target them with any sort of precision. You will always overshoot your aim, and there's no lock-on system. And whatever supposed auto-aim this game claims to have isn't there, so it feels like you're playing San Andreas with no Z-targeting. It feels really bad, and because 50's no marksman, you have to spray random, leading to these very frustrating and clunky shootouts. Anytime you feel like the game is getting any better, you end up hitting a firefight that you know you'll have to replay ad nauseum. I've seen this cutscene of Tony Yayo falling through the floor too many times. Oh, you also get a sniper rifle, but you can't zoom in with it, so every shot has to be a 350 no scope. There's the camera, which being typically placed over the shoulder and really close in on 50, you have a very limited view of your surroundings. This wouldn't be a big deal, but it becomes a huge headache when some of these levels start with these sections where you have to explore the environment looking for random bullshit to progress. This is one of those games where enemies will infinitely respawn, so then you have to manage the impossible task of exploring the environment, finding what you need to progress, holding off waves and waves of bullet sponge enemies in this nightmare gameplay loop where you can barely aim properly, and you're all doing this on limited health. It's like they really dropped the ball hard here in these aspects to the point where it's almost this broken disaster.
What am I saying? 50 Cent Bulletproof is a masterpiece by every definition of the word. I was joking earlier. I was joshing. Everything bad I said was a goof.
10th level. Thousands of G units. You have to help me. He's always watching.
Halfway through the game, you and M fittingly visit this white trash dump in another one of those sections that at first are not so bad. Like, the actual combat can feel good. These weapons feel very powerful when you get a good handle on the jankiness, but it all goes crashing when, yep, enemies start respawning all over again. And you can't even see where they're firing from because you can barely see past Curtis's inflated rescue hero shoulder blades. Speaking of, oh my god, it's white trash Marcus Phoenix.
Spider tells me you're late.
Sorry, man, things got fucked up.
You're not following me. When he said late, he meant it like the late K-Dog.
Yeah, check his pockets. Oh shit, is that a copy of Gears of War 2? It's like a metaphor or something. Most of these levels also have a boss battle. None of them really stuck out to me. Thank God, most of them can be cheesed pretty easily, but let me tell you, there were some really close calls there. Like this one where you have to go into a meth lab and fight Sephiroth's brother, Metharoth.
You have failed again, I see. But through suffering, you will.
Heads up, pussy!
Oh shit, is that a Final Fantasy game in his pocket? It's like a crisis core or something. So after you get all the vitamin water health upgrades and get access to more powerful and explosive weapons and better armor, things do come together a little bit. It does become manageable, and that good game I was talking about does start to bleed through. Some of these parts can get pretty fun, but then you get trucked by some bullshit shootout. It's so sad. It's like watching a caveman almost invent fire before dying from a mild cold. There is a world where instead of 50 Cent Bulletproof, we got 50 Cent Bulletstorm, where you could, you know, aim down the sights and fire more accurately and have a better handle of these frustrating sections, where this game went down in history as a pretty ahead of the curve over the shoulder shooter with some fun, gory executions and a great soundtrack. I'm like, come on, there are plenty of other games from around that time that pulled off similar mechanics in a much smoother way. Like you take the Scarface game that came out just a few months later, and that game really accomplished what Bulletproof was trying to do so well. He got this crazy over-the-top shooter with cartoonish violence, ragdoll carnage, and executions that feel really good to play because you can get this, lock on to enemies. And because the lock on still gives you some degree of movement with the reticle, you can still shoot off specific parts and nutsacks galore. If Bulletproof had adopted a similar aiming system, you'd get a much more satisfying shooter without having to compromise those high-precision headshots either. That's why I did want to bring up the portable version we got for PSP, 50 Cent Bulletproof G-Unit Edition. Rather than being a one-to-one port of the PS2 and Xbox version, we instead get a top-down shooter from the perspective of God himself. Now, at the time, this was probably a bit disappointing, especially since we know the PSP was very well capable of delivering very impressive and faithful ports of PS2 games, but this is actually one of those instances where I'm actually glad we got something different. The spirit of the game is very much intact. You'll be kicking corpses for money, pulling off these stylish execution kills, the cutscenes and story beats are all the same, but the actual combat makes for this much cleaner and manageable experience because you can actually lock onto enemies. You have a mini-map, what? The top-down view makes exploration much more viable. It's a game that stays true to the essence of the console version and ditches a lot of its worst aspects, and to me, that's a huge win. And like the console version, you can buy a lot of 50 Cent's best songs and music videos, but this time, it's portable. So if you were that kid on the bus trying to take all the girls to the candy shop, you could bust out your PSP in this game. Or, you know, you could just, you know, buy the album on PSP. That was also an option. So, the console version of Bulletproof didn't quite pan out. It was cool to see a rapper starring in his own game. It had a lot of cool qualities to it that was close to reaching the heights of being a fantastic third-person shooter that could have even been considered ahead of its time. But look, if there's one thing I know, it's never count out 50. Because you never know when down the line the world might need to call upon him. Again.
Has changed. War has begun ravaging a non-specific country in the Middle East. War. They make games about war. Third-person shooters about war. The economy of war games has become a well-oiled machine. And brother, you either get rich or die trying.
1, 2, 3, let's go!
Look.
That's right, it's 50 Cent Blood on the Sand, the best video game starring a rapper since E40 Winks.
While similar games from that era may use this Middle East backdrop to explore themes like war profiteering or using gameplay conventions to demonstrate the ease of which soldiers will commit atrocities, only Blood on the Sand dares to boldly exclaim the unsettling truth. That bitch took my skull.
Where'd she go? That bitch took my skull.
While Blood in the Sand has certainly gained quite a following in recent years as this unlikely bombastic third-person shooter, when it came out, it was kind of weird to see, like, oh, they made another 50 Cent game? Now? See, by 2009, when this game was released, 50 just didn't quite have the same relevancy anymore. A lot of people point to Graduation outselling Curtis in the US as the end of the story, but it was more that his music just started to feel a bit more of the same, and that specific sound of gangster rap was just going out of style. He was still popular, obviously, but nowhere near as pervasive as he once was. And with a whole new wave of rappers being discovered every day on sites like DatPiff or MySpace, it definitely became harder for him to adapt to that changing sound. Blood in the Sand, bombing sales-wise, wasn't just a fool-me-twice situation after Bulletproof, but it was also a matter of, why bother? Which is a shame, because the end product we did end up with was just about everything I could have wanted from a 50 Cent game. Everything has been buttoned up from Bulletproof, successfully working off a lot of the advances made in the third-person shooter genre to a point where, to me, this game might as well be some prequel to the Gears trilogy. The shooting mechanics here are actually really satisfying, and I'm gonna tell you, the controls are even tighter than some other games that came out around that time with a much bigger budget. Rather than rolling with all of G-Unit in this army of 2-bit gangsters co-op shooter, you can only select one of them to be your second man. There's DJ Who Kid, Tony Yayo, Arbiter, but I'm sorry guys, I had to go with my man Lloyd and Space Banks. You got all of the 7th gen third-person shooter tropes here you could possibly pack in. You got two buff dudes lifting a garage door together between locations. You got hidden loading screens where the game forces you to walk super slow while the screen becomes all letterboxed. And you, of course, got the Unreal Engine 3 sheen where the lighting sometimes makes 50 looks like he swallowed a star of forbidden knowledge.
I tire of these G's. These units. I tire of being caught in the continuous popping of these things.
The first time I saw myself In a video game, I was really excited about it because it looks so much like me.
And of course, you have your typical section where you take out a turret gunner and oh, what's gonna happen? Is a big swarm of enemies gonna show up like fish in a barrel? Oh shit, they do! I don't care how cliche this shit is, I will be here for it till the end of time.
Climb up to the Citadel, I'll give you air support.
Damn, who put you in charge?
Looks like I'm in charge.
You a crazy bitch, you know that? That's my kind of girl.
I think what makes this premise work so well is just how much they play into the absurdity of it all. The idea of a 50 Cent game already is wild. So of course, throwing him into the Middle East as a fish out of water character is just a bunch of fun. The writing here is a lot funnier and self-aware. The whole gang 50 is just trying to get back a stolen, priceless historical skull given to him as payment for his Middle Eastern concert, and that's basically it. And the death toll he's willing to pile up to get it back is incalculable. I love the gameplay loop here. Everything has been turned up to 11 in this high-octane explosive shooter where you can shred through enemies with this very arcadey setup. See, each section awards you points which you can earn by chaining kills together in these combos, so you're always rushing to increase your multiplier before time runs out, and with each shootout, the game will also throw these little time target objectives. And if you pull them off, they reward you with things like an explosive pistol or one with flammable rounds. It really keeps every moment exciting and engaging and a real cut above your run-of-the-mill cover shooter. What's also an absolute blast is they gave Curtis bullet time powers that has a ton of utility since you can use it to keep your combos going, and man, I love this game. This system gives each level a lot more replay value as you try to earn the most money and net the highest score for more weapons, upgrades, and 50 tracks. You do have some collectibles that earn you points too, like posters and these hidden targets along the way. The one thing, though, I'd say is the singular step down from Bulletproof, believe it or not, are the execution kills. In Bulletproof, they were quick, flashy, and simple, and operated as this nice momentary breather before jumping back into the action. But here, of course, some of the 7th gen bad habits seep their way in by making you do these elongated quicktime events every time. But everything else as a whole has been streamlined and cleaned up to bring this explosive co-op shooter, with the one major setback being that there is no split screen like Gears of War.
War. This is perhaps the most disappointing and damning sin to this game's legacy. Because as of now, on Xbox, the only way to play co-op is if you and your buddy both have Xbox Live Gold on two separate systems and two copies of the game, which has been skyrocketing in price the last year or so. Oh, and also Blood on the Sand miraculously ended up being the last 360 game to be added to the backwards compatibility list for the Xbox One and Series X, but it's one of the few on that list that Microsoft didn't make available digitally on their store. So, of course, you still need two physical copies to do co-op. Luckily, I bought it way before the price got insane, dusted off my 360 since it's the latest Xbox I own, connected online for the first time in forever, started a Game Pass free trial so I could have a gold subscription real quick, and played co-op with the lone random fellow that happened to be online. And you know, it was a lot like finding a fellow traveler in a vast, desolate desert with no form of communication available aside from the in-game taunt button.
This is war,
piece
bitch!
Of fucking shit.
Man, I'm sick of this shit
right
here!
Fuck yourself!
Fuck all you!
And let me tell you, I had a blast journeying with my first Xbox Live companion in many, many years, as we unleashed hell in our pimped-out warpath. Together, we didn't just inflict blood on these sands, no. We experienced a journey, an inseparable bond that we wouldn't soon ever forget. And then he said he had to go to bed. So yeah, the licensing would be a challenge, but please, 50, I beg of you, we need a remaster. Just some way to keep the lifeblood on the sands of this game flowing for years to come so I could play couch co-op with a buddy without needing to potentially drop over $100. For years, just at a cursory glance, this game was always easy to write off as, oh, it's probably garbo. But for most people who do come across this one, it ends up being quite shocking how fun it is. To me, Blood on the Sand is a personal classic. You get this insanely fun arcade shooter where you can sit back and vibe to the absolute best of 50 Cent's catalog. I want more. It's been almost 15 years and this game's cult following only grows bigger every day, and we're really overdue for some hip-hop video games. I'm telling you, if 50 came back with another one or even just a remaster, I will be there day one, I promise you. Give us anything. I don't care how crazy it is. Give me a 50 Cent Infamous game. Give me Curtis May Cry. I don't care. In the meantime, it's Jimmy Iovine time, and at least we have Blood on the Sand. Hello? Yeah, that's what we're doing. We're doing that right now. What? What do you mean I missed his birthday? No. No. I was too late. I got the bad ending. 50, if you're watching this, I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. Please spare me. We can watch Power together. You love Power. Please, 50. Don't come after me.
Nobody likes me.